Respected faculty members, staff members, dignitaries, and my dear friends, a hearty good evening to all. We have gathered here today to celebrate Constitution Day. Constitution Day is celebrated on 26 November every year to commemorate the adoption of the Constitution of India, which gave our country a direction to grow and prosper. To speak on the significance of this auspicious day, I, Apurva Jana, on behalf of Manipal School of Life Sciences, Mahe, I am pleased to introduce today's guest speaker, Sri Seshadri Ramanujan Chari, Secretary General, Forum for Integrated National Security and Member of Planning and Monitoring Board, Mahe, Manipal. Sri Seshadri Ramanujan Chari is a journalist, politician, strategic and a foreign policy analyst. He is currently engaged as Director of International Affairs at the Institute for National Security Studies, Director, Forum for Strategic and Security Studies, and several other distinguished bodies. He is a well-known political commentator and regularly appears in news channels and also has published several books related to foreign policies. With this brief introduction, I kindly invite Sri Seshadri Chari to address the gathering.
Okay, now. I think people can hear me. It's not necessary that they should see me. Oh, not a very presentable face. Anyway, respected director, Mr. Satyamurthy, friends and students, I'm told that a number of students are joining us online, so I should not go by the number of people present in front of me. So it's an indication of what is going to be in future. It is okay for an academician or a professor to do all these things, but when it comes to a politician, I'm sure politicians are not going to really like this coronavirus pandemic, because politicians are used to seeing number of people in front of them. More the people, more the josh in them. That is the whole thing. So We have all heard about the Constitution of India. Constitution is not a new thing for us. Although we observe 26th January as the Republic Day, 26 January 1950 as the Republic Day, but from 2015 onwards, in 2015, the Ministry of Social Justice declared 29th November, observing 29th November, 26th November, as the Constitution Day. In fact, before that, the same day was observed as the Law Day also, because Constitution is the source of all the laws. A country is governed by rules, regulations, or law, what we call. In fact, we have all heard the term rule of law. Whatever happens has to happen by the rule of law. If there is no law, if there is no rule of law, there will be total chaos, confusion. So it is always said that there has to be a rule of law. In fact, what is the significance? You can know the significance of rule of law. Why do you need a rule of law? They say different types of nyaya, justice is there. Rule of jungle rule. Law of the jungle is a very typical term. Law of the jungle means whoever is strong wins. That is law of the jungle. If you are weak, you are dead. But that cannot be applied to a society which is evolved. So as an evolved society, we have this idea of rule of law. In fact, there are some references in Narada Puran. There is a reference. And in Narada Puran, there is a reference saying, Nashte dharme manushyanam vyavahara pravartate. It's very simple to understand. Sanskrit is a very simple language. Most of the Indian languages have evolved out of Sanskrit, so we can understand. Now, the word dharma has to be understood in a proper context. Unfortunately, the dictionary meaning of dharma, or in general we say dharma means religion. No, dharma is not religion. Obviously, the word religion did not exist when Narada must have said this or written this. Therefore, dharma is not religion. Dharma can be at the most translated as law. In this context, or rules, regulations, or in today's context, the Constitution. Dharma can be at best said as the Constitution. All the rules and regulations. So there he says, Nashte dharme. If the dharma is not there, which means if there is no rule of law, if there is no constitution, there is no guiding principles, how people should behave, if it is not there, Nashte dharme manushyana vyavahara pravartate. Vyavahara means conflict. In colloquial language, we also use this word, some vyavahara is there. So vyavahara is not behavior. Vyavahara in literal terms means conflict. So if the rule of law does not exist, if the rule of law fails, if there is no rules, no regulations, if there is no constitution, then conflict starts. So this is the importance of dharma or rule of law or constitution. So that is the importance of constitution. So when the constitution was being to be framed, the first meeting of the Constituent Assembly took place in 1946. So it took almost 3 years for the Constituent Assembly to prepare the constitution. And on 26th November, the constitution was finally prepared. And it was not an easy thing. Unlike today, today we cannot imagine something of this magnitude must have happened. But more than 2,000 amendments were done to the original constitution which was prepared. In these 3 years, so many drafts were prepared. If at all you people should get an opportunity to go to some of the best libraries in India, there is a library within the parliament also. And in that library, there are volumes of about 18 books. They are called the discussion notes on the Constituent Assembly. When the Constituent Assembly was sitting and they were discussing each and every provision of the Constitution, they took notes. So there will be one provision, one article on which they will write. The Constitution of India is the longest written constitution in the world. And when we say written constitution, the funniest part of it is the entire constitution in English and Hindi was handwritten. It was not typed. The original copy of the constitution was handwritten. Not that typewriter was not available in those days, but the whole idea of typing the constitution did not occur or was not there at all. So it was actually handwritten. It seems the original constitution, the handwritten constitution, has 1,17,369 words. And Prem Bihari Raizada was the person. Prem Bihari ji practically wrote about 395 articles. Constitution has got 395 articles and 22 parts and 8 schedules. And now I think it has got about 440 articles. Again, 22 parts are there, and the number of schedules has gone from 8 to 12. So imagine 1,17,000 words. We write articles of 800,000 words, 3,000 words, 5,000 words. We type. But imagine a person, he was a calligrapher. So if you have seen the constitution, copy of the constitution, original copy, in that italic style it is written, every page of the constitution was written by this man. Single-handed, he sat and wrote the entire constitution in English and Hindi. And there were a number of artists in Shantiniketan in those days. So after writing each page, this person would hand over the page to the artist. You must have heard of Nandalal Bose. Nandalal Bose was one of the artists Sinha, Ram Bihari Sinha, I think. These two people used to draw. Nandalal Bose did not sign his name, but there is one page in the original constitution where there is a photograph of Ram, Sita and Lakshman. And in that page, at the bottom, there is a small writing signature of Ram, Sinha. He doesn't write Sinha, only his name. So that is the only page where the name of the artist is written. Otherwise, the man who wrote the entire constitution by hand, Raizada, he never wrote his name anywhere. Nandalal Bose did not sign anywhere. This is the only copy which was signed. This original copy of the constitution is in parliament. It's a huge box, metal box, and it is preserved in that metal box with a glass cover, which was adopted on 24th January 1950, all the members of the Constituent Assembly came and signed the document. But on 26th November 1949, it was adopted. Till that time, all these procedures were going on. Another very unique feature is, although it is the longest written constitution, which says what should be the form of government, and it says in the Constituent Assembly when it was being made, and the Constituent Assembly was, the chairman of the Constituent Assembly was Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. So when he spoke about the constitution, he has number of places he has said. So the first question that came before all the members of Constituent Assembly, incidentally, the some 4 or 5 years back, the last member of the Constituent Assembly also died. As of now, not a single member of the original Constituent Assembly is alive, which is very obvious because it was adopted on in 1949. So anyone who must have been a member in 1949 must have been at least 25 years of age. So nobody could live beyond that period. So nobody is alive. Nobody from the original member of the Constituent Assembly is alive today. Not even people who were living at that time, who were staff, nobody is there. So everything that is recorded from history only we could get. So the whole idea of writing a constitution, first of all, the Constituent Assembly members, some of them first came to, when they came together, the first discussion was whether we should have a constitution at all. Can this country be governed without a constitution? So one of the members, H.V. Kamath, I think, he said, this country was not born yesterday. 1947, 15th August 1947, we became independent politically. Then after 2 years, we decided that we will have a constitution. So before the British came also, there was India was there. As a country, there was there. We had rules, regulations. We had Maharaja, we had governance, we had Raja, we had political establishment. So many things were there. So what was the necessity? What is the necessity? Do we require a constitution at all? The whole question started from there. Then they said, yes, we require a constitution because we have so many rules and regulations, no doubt about it. But the people of India who have fought for the freedom should be given a guarantee that, look, here is a document which the people of India themselves prepare and adopt, enact, and adopt and give unto themselves. That is why the preamble says, we the people of India, we the people. The constitution was not given by some XYZ, or the Constituent Assembly doesn't say, this Constituent Assembly hereby gives you the constitution. No, they say this constitution belongs to the people of India. So we the people. Very ironically, the term we the people itself was borrowed from the US Constitution. The first line of the US Constitution is we the people of United States of America. So we copied the same words, we the people of America, we the people. That way, so many constitutions of the world, Canadian Constitution, Australian Constitution, are all adopted. It's very strange. The Australian Constitution speaks about the form of government. We have adopted the cabinet form of government. United States has got a different form of government. So we adopted the Westminster system of governance. So we have a prime minister and we have a cabinet minister and then a cabinet and all these things. So this whole system of running of governance, system of governance, parliament, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, the words Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha was different, but because the term Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha were borrowed from the ancient scriptures. The latest scripture from where it was all borrowed was the Arthashastra of Chanakya. In Arthashastra, Chanakya explains about the importance of rule of the people. So the he coined two words, Sabha and Samiti. Sabha is a council of ministers. Samiti is a larger group of people who are represented. And this Sabha and Samiti, how a country is to be governed? The country has to be governed through Sabha and Samiti. These words are actually the Vedic words. Ayurveda prescribes the forms of government, and in that forms of government, it talks about Sabha and Samiti. So it has been running for a long time. Anyway, we won't go into those details. Very difficult to comprehend and explain now. So these words Sabha and Samiti, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha and Samiti, were all copied from so many sources. But the Australian constitution says how the government has to be done. But the funniest part of the Australian constitution is, it says the Australian constitution is framed on the lines of the British constitution. So the whole Australian constitution, which is a written constitution again, is based on the British constitution. But the funniest part is, Britain does not have a written constitution at all. Britain does not have a constitution at all. The entire British system of governance is run on tradition. So the Britain runs it on tradition only. By tradition, they have certain rules, regulations and all that. And on the basis of that, they govern. So Britain does not have a written constitution. But the British, on the basis of the British constitution, the Australian constitution is framed. And on the basis of that Australian constitution, government of India's rules and regulations are framed. So US, UK, so much so that the most ironical part of it is, there is a provision in the constitution for fundamental rights. We all know about it. So everybody has got a fundamental right. Fundamental right of association, fundamental right of speech, fundamental right of writing, everything. All kinds of fundamental rights. These are all, education is a fundamental right. So this right cannot be denied to a citizen by the government, except in some cases. If there is a serious emergency, a threat to the security of the country, only in some such conditions, the fundamental right can be suspended. The Constitution says this, and we all probably know, the first time the fundamental rights were suspended was in 1975, when emergency was imposed. There is a grave threat to the very existence of the country, Mrs. Indira Gandhi at that time said, and she imposed emergency. This emergency was imposed under the provision of the suspension of fundamental rights clause. And the suspension of fundamental rights clause was adopted from the Weimar Constitution of Germany, which was the same Weimar Constitution which Hitler used to become a dictator. So we have adopted from all the constitutions of the world, all good, bad things, everything. So now then we had a beautiful constitution, very strongly worded constitution, taken care of each and every aspect of the society. So now nothing can go wrong in this country. That is what people used to say. So it seems in one of the speeches, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar was asked, so now that we have a constitution, you think we have no problem with the governance system in this country? Then Babasaheb Ambedkar's speech is very, very monumental speech he made in the parliament. He said, this country cannot be governed only by the constitution. However good the constitution may be, if the people are bad and disunited, this country will be ruined. On the other hand, however bad the constitution may be, if people are good and strongly united, we will preserve our democracy. So the man who is considered to be the father of Indian constitution has this to say, that this country is governed not only by the constitution, but the goodness of the people and the unity and integrity of the people. And that is the guarantee that the constitution ultimately gives. 1930, the first resolution of Purna Swaraj. In fact, 26th January 1930, the first Purna Swaraj resolution was passed. That is why the constitution was adopted, but it came into effect on 26 January 1950 to commemorate the 1930 resolution of Purna Swaraj. So that is why these two dates become very independent, very important. The day when the constitution was completed and adopted, the Constituent Assembly adopted that constitution. And at that time, there were provisions that the constitution, when it was made, adopted, everything, when it was being written, so many people said that if you make a law, who can change it? Can a law be made which can be changed? And if the law can be changed, what is the sanctity of that law? If I make a law saying that this is the door through which everybody should go out, so it becomes a rule. And if I say that tomorrow anybody can decide whether to go out of this door or not, then that rule loses its sanctity. So what should do? At the same time, if you make a rule today for the society, do you have the moral and legal right to bind future generations with what you think is right or wrong today? Can you make it that way static? So this question came up. Then the Constituent Assembly decided that yes, we must have a provision. We are making the rules for today. But if tomorrow society decides that this particular rule or law or act or article is wrong and redundant, they should have the freedom to change it. So that is why there is a provision of amendments. Now we must have, the constitution is probably amended more than 100 times, 115 times. But the major amendment was brought out in 1976. You can change any other rule and regulation, but the preamble of the constitution, basic structure of the constitution, can it be changed? There is a huge debate on this issue. They said the preamble of the constitution cannot be changed, but we will not provide it in the constitution that the preamble cannot be changed. If somebody tomorrow decides to change the preamble, they can change the preamble also. But they said this preamble is so beautifully worded that there won't be necessity to change it. Very fortunately or unfortunately, 1976, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, who used the provision of the Weimar Constitution to declare emergency, amended the preamble also and added two words. One was socialism and one was secularism. Otherwise, the original constitution said, we the people of India give unto ourselves this day a democratic republic country. We were democratic, we were republic. We did not qualify these two words, socialism and secularism, are adjectives. When I say I am a socialist, it's an adjective. When I say I am a Hindu, it's an adjective. That is why when we say Hindu Rashtra, it's not one word, there are two words, Hindu and Rashtra. Rashtra is permanent, Hindu is the adjective of that Rashtra. Like communist Rashtra, capitalist Rashtra, socialist Rashtra, free Rashtra, united Rashtra. These are all adjectives. So Hindu is an adjective. Who is a Hindu? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 qualifications. If you have these qualifications, you are Hindu. They are not defined anyway. We won't go into that subject so soon. It's very difficult to get into that area. But these are all adjectives. So these two adjectives, socialist and republic, socialist and secular, were added. Whatever the reason, people who drafted the constitution, were they foolish that they did not think of this? Actually, there is a huge debate and discussion on this also. It was debated whether we should say that we are a secular country. Again, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's speech in the Constituent Assembly explaining why the word secular need not be mentioned in the constitution, he explains. He says, secularism is there in our blood, so why do we want to say it? And we are secular not because the constitution says we are secular, but we are secular in spite of the constitution saying it. This is Babasaheb Ambedkar's speech. So if you go into all those details, it's a beautiful work brought out by the most intellectual group in this country who thought about almost everything for the future, but they've laid a very strong fundamental template on which we would be able to govern ourselves. So that is the importance. The more we learn about the constitution, of course, nobody can say that I have learned everything about the constitution. But the Constituent Assembly debates, it's a volume of some 18 books. If one goes through each and every page of that, if somebody is able to do research on the Constituent Assembly debates books, that itself will monumentally bring out the history of this country. So on this day, we pay our respects and homage to all those people who drafted this, one of the most lengthy, longest written, and most beautiful document of the country, on the basis of which we are still existing as a democracy, we are still existing as a unified country, and we are able to rule our own selves, and we are able to do all the correct, all the wrong things, and avoid doing the wrong things only on the basis of this constitution. And it is the constitution which saves us from chaos and conflict, as Narad said, Nashte dharme manushyanam vyavahara pravartate. So it is the constitution which is keeping us safe from chaos and confusion and conflict. So it is good that we remember this day and pay our tributes and homage to all those people who wrote this constitution. Since I am not an expert on any subject, including the Constitution of India, I think I leave it to the students to study for themselves maximum about all these issues and benefit out of it. Thank you. Yeah. You want to?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, my God.
So there is a debate which is going on. You say whether it should even go in the constitution to call ourselves as Bharat or Hindustan. What are your thoughts?
See, the original constitution uses both the words, India and Bharat. That is why the constitution says India, that is Bharat. So there was a debate on this also, because the original constitution was written in English. So they wrote India, but when the constitution was being simultaneously translated and written in Hindi also, wherever the word India was used, the Hindi translation used the word Bharat. So this question came, can proper nouns be translated? India is a proper name. So, I mean, if I say Professor Truth Idol, you don't become Truth Idol. When you go to America or England, there also you will remain Satyamurthy. Satya is truth, Murthy is idol. So Satyamurthy will remain Satyamurthy. It won't become Truth Idol there. One of my friends used to always say that the first person who landed on the moon was Nilubhau Bhujbal. Always impossible. Bhujbal is a politician in Maharashtra. But the man who landed on the moon was Neil Armstrong. So Neil is Neil. Armstrong is Bhujbal. So why don't you say Neil Armstrong? So can India be translated to Bharat? Then the question came, who gave the name India? Then who gave the name Bharat? Which is more ancient, India or Bharat? Should we name the country as Bharat? All this confusion came. So they finally said, some future generation will decide what should be the name of the country. But as of today, we recognize this country as India and we also recognize this country as Bharat. So we put an end to this debate here. So to be, in order to make whether it is right or wrong, in order to finish the subject, they decided to add this word India, that is Bharat. So when you say India, you understand it as Bharat. When you say Bharat, you understand it as India. That is how they came up. So this question comes up again and again, whether we should retain the word India or whether we should retain the word Bharat. All these things came up. There were so many issues which were left to some future generation to decide. Another issue was about the Rashtragan. So in English it is national anthem. So in Hindi it became Rashtragan. But is nation is equal to Rashtra? So if nation is Rashtra, what is state? Then when you say head of state, Pope is the head of Vatican. Vatican is a state. Vatican is also a country. Pope is the head of Vatican. Pope is also the supreme leader of Vatican. So when Pope comes to India, he is given as head of the state status. Like the American president is head of the state. The Queen is the head of the state in UK, not the Prime Minister. The President of India is the head of the state, not the Prime Minister. So when you say head of the country, you also say head of the state. But India has got 29 states. They are called Rajya. So Rashtra Bhasha and Rajya Bhasha. Rashtragan and Rajyagan. which will be correct, and whether Janagana Mana should be the Rashtragan or Vande Mataram should be. This issue was also came up. What should be the flag? There was a flag committee, and the flag committee said the flag should represent the sacrifice of the people of India. So many millions of lakhs of people have died for the freedom. So what should be the symbol of the sacrifice? So the symbol of sacrifice is fire, or they say bhagwa, saffron. Saffron symbolizes sacrifice. That is why these sadhus and all, they wear saffron clothes. Saffron means he has given up everything in life. So sacrifice is associated, or saffron color is associated with sacrifice. So the flag committee decided that the flag of India should be saffron color flag. It was the original decision. And incidentally, the chairman of the flag committee was also Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. But when it went to the Constituent Assembly, it was rejected. Whatever reason and all that, I won't go into those details. So these debates are still pending, unanswered. So some future generation will answer these debates and once and for all decide that the name of this country will henceforth be only India and not Bharat, or they may decide the name of the country will be Bharat and not India. But this whole premise on which the constitution is based, that India that is Bharat, sounds a little odd. India that is Bharat is virtually translating a proper noun, which is, according to English grammar, is wrong. Very difficult question to answer, sir. See, the uniqueness of Indian constitution is that judiciary is completely independent. So that uniqueness is maintained. So Supreme Court is the final authority as far as the interpretation of the constitution is concerned. Parliament cannot interpret the constitution. Parliament cannot say this is right or this is wrong. Only Supreme Court can say. But when it comes to amendment, if the Supreme Court amends, makes an amendment, and if the parliament thinks that this amendment is not acceptable, the parliament can annul that. So there, when it comes to the right of amendment, parliament becomes supreme. Because parliament is the legislature. Judiciary is also created out of the rules and regulations framed by the constituents, constituent assembly, which was elected by the people of India. So it is the people of India who have made that law, the people of India who have made judiciary, people of India who have created judiciary, people of India who have created judiciary independent from the parliament. So ultimately, parliament represents the collective will of the people of India, not the Supreme Court. The Chief Justice of Supreme Court is not elected by the people of India. The members of the parliament are elected by the people of India. So they are supreme. Therefore, the final authority as far as amendment is concerned rests on them. This is very clearly amplified in Shah Banu case, where the Supreme Court's diktat was annulled by the parliament. There are so many other things also. Keshavananda Bharati case also is there. So many things are there. But ultimate authority as far as amendment is concerned rests with the parliament, not with the Supreme Court. Supreme Court can interpret. Oh, good question. There are a number of countries which have adopted from Indian constitution, like Bangladesh has adopted a number of things from the Indian constitution. Nepal has a constitution, and Nepal's constitution has also got a number of provisions, especially the federal provisions about the country, because Nepal was against federalism, but then they adopted it from the Indian constitution. So Indian constitution is a unitary constitution, so but with federal features, so that uniqueness is there. And I can give you so many instances where the Indian constitutional provisions were adopted. The Cambodian government framed the constitution, and they also adopted a number of provisions from India, especially about elections and all that, and about formation of states also. And Sri Lankan constitution, they took some provisions, but there was a provision about federalism which they did not take, they did not accept it, but for various other reasons. But at least one constitution where, with which I was personally associated in preparing the constitution, adopted more than 80% of the provisions provided by the constitution of India, especially to the nature of framing of Representation of Peoples Act, is the constitution of South Sudan. I was the consultant, United Nations consultant and posted in South Sudan, consultant on governance. So that is the time they were making the constitution. So I was part of the constitution making process. So since I was part of it, I drafted a number of provisions which were there in the Indian constitution and handed over to them, including provisions about participation of women in the post-conflict democratic resolutions. So many things. So that is there. Two or three other African countries have also adopted some of our provisions. Some of the amendments that they have made to their constitution depends on the amendments that we have made. For example, reservation for women. This was adopted by some constitutions based on the system of reservation that we discussed but not adopted. It is there. Women's Reservation Bill has not yet been passed. But how to conduct an election with the help of reservation, that they got. Interesting questions. Yeah. That is actually the, it's called plebiscite. We don't have the provision for plebiscite in our constitution. It was mentioned in the rules and regulations of the Dominion of India Act. Again, our constitution, the basic structure of our constitution is based on the 1935 India Act, Government of India Act 1935. Government of India Act 1935 has a provision for plebiscite, but that was never used, neither by the British nor by the free government of 1947. So we don't have that provision as such. The Irish constitution has the provision. But the British government did not accept that provision of the Irish constitution. So, and since we adopted the governance system from Australia, which was again based on the traditions of Great Britain, there was nothing, no written provision about plebiscite. So we don't have it. But Irish constitution has got what they call the directive principles of state policy. The state shall do this 1, 2, 3, 4. So that it's not the state should or can, it shall. It is duty bound to do this. If not today, after 100 years, but the state should do it. These are all called the directive principles of state policy. That we have adopted from the Irish constitution. But we don't have this provision of plebiscite. Done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your insightful talk. If there are no further questions, I'd like to thank everyone for their audience and have a good evening. Thank you.